The topic is negative index Möbius strip resonator for next generation electron signal sources. The author is Ulrich, Rohde, myself, Dr. Eisele, Professor Rubiola. And these are the very mysterious strip that many institutes like Bergman University, Synergy Microwave, Fraunhofer, and Femtoinstitut Institute are involved. We did the foundry run from the Femto frequent Fraunhofer Research Institute in Munich, Germany, and we'll discuss, we'll give brief outline, introduction and backgrounds, negative index Möbius strips, what it is, resonator for next generation high frequency sources, why it is next generation, because still mathematics and physics, they go along that one. We haven't able to finalize very unified way how the epsilon and mu have a dynamics. It is energy cycling, interesting feature because it requires very low energy to work. You might see the even passive structure become regenerative structures. We have pros and cons, what will be happen because nothing is free in this world. If something have positive, you have to see the other side also. Then we'll have a typical negative index inspired oscillators. We will have validation conclusion. The sign of go green while giving cycling, it is possible here we can make nearly 90% energy dissipation to use as eigen resources. So that is that's why many scientists all over the world investing a lot of research time and resources to go metamaterial medium as a source. One can ask what is negative index medium? To date, and tomorrow we can find there will be, probably I have read a New York Times and many papers. This field will bring at least 10 Nobel Prize if somebody can found first the materials and many applications. It has been arbitrary structure. The first gentleman from UK, Professor Pendry, has demonstrated at terahertz, the mu and epsilon can be negative. The region this material properties, which has a unique characteristic atomic level, the structure you can see in atomic scale, the dimension are between two radial is A0, then you have atomic homogenization. This is split ring, what Pendry came about, and then you have to effective homogenization. The region why it is very difficult, it is not following the reciprocity theorem, homogeneous theorem, superposition theorem, because the structure become complex and epsilon and mu depends upon many factors. It's not only depend upon frequency, it's orientation, polarization, position, excitation, many things. So if your structure becomes very insignificant in length with comparable to incident operating wavelength, you can apply the homogeneous theorem based on existing Maxwell rule. The structure, I just brought the first left half here. This is right hand material, the world we live in and we discuss or we work around, which is epsilon zero, mu greater than zero. We haven't found maybe distant galaxy. We didn't have even astrophysical science, any report where somewhere any matter has shown both at the same times a negative index. It can be the inability because our measuring equipment is still not devised to measure those parameters in absolute sense. The third quadrant, which is most important for us, which is less epsilon, less than zero, mu less than zero. Some people say it's a left-handed medium because it was nomenclature for positive index right-handed medium. From 2000, it has been more familiar and glamorized as a metamaterials. If you see the unique expression, many passive like filter resonator guy, and we happily do how the energy equation can be derived, which is epsilon E square plus mu H square, where E and H is electric field, magnetic field. If epsilon and mu go simultaneously negative, what will happen? The energy will be negative, which doesn't obey the rules of, any medium which has electric magnetic field, the energy, total energy will be negative. So this doesn't address our problems. Now the unified solution can be, if you differentiate omega with respect to omega and mu also, then even epsilon and mu becomes negative, the energy equation holds good. But problem becomes severe, along the presentation you will see that this no longer only depend upon frequency, it depends on other factor also. Very interesting paper came 2011, a gentleman who has got Nobel Prize in graphene, and people from Germany and other part of the country, they devise from the graphene nanotube structure, simply ring structure, and put them a Möbius strip. I'll spend 5 to 6 minutes more in the time in the metamaterial, then you go to Möbius, otherwise it will be very complex. What they did it, the frequency of the FT cutoff, they have increased 4 times. Just in atomic scale, this is exaggerated in dimension. All atomic structure arrangement will be the Möbius strip kind of things. They have improved the thermal properties and the frequency properties, and bandwidth becomes like, you know, very high. So very good candidate if we can develop whole series of inductance, capacitance, even active devices. Now, what are challenges we have there? It is very recent time atomic metal came in pictures, and since 2004, Dr. Smith from Duke University, Dr. Penry from UK, many people from Australia and America, everybody is trying their level best to bring the frequency of operation at microwave that can make our sense. Because terahertz, everything comes photonic and optics, the phenomena will be observed, experimentally verified, but any useful information you have to bring in radio micro frequency domain. What is happening over here, they have done array of split ring wire. Let me explain you, the split ring and wire. Wire gives you like permittivity sensitivity, and this ring gives you close permeability. So they make a structure in wire in composite dimension, they sandwich them. So if you inject plane over here, they will see totally different kind of scattering, VSWR reflection parameter, which in Maxwell equation only can be proved if you design epsilon mu equal negatives. So what it says over here, any material supporting single propagation mode at a non-frequency usually exhibits well-defined index, which we know it. It follows the rule, and like if you define the impedance, Z will be square root over mu of epsilon. For a space becomes 277 ohm, it's no problem. But problem becomes severe when you take the Möbius structure in metamaterial form, which become bias banisotropic, then it becomes function of frequency, polarization, excitation, geometry, and topology. Exhibit different value of impedance, the forward and backward impedance becomes different. So we can, even you have resonator, you do not know what will be impedance along the structures. So we cannot define the Q, cannot define mu, cannot define epsilon. So experimentally, we observe very good phase noise performance. We'll show the experimental result, but mathematical CAD tool is still failed to stay in the mathematical domain, how to address those problems, how uniquely you can predict them. And few more are there. Assuming the size of negative index metamaterial structure, which people talk about, I said that Dr. Smith and Pendry and 10 more scientists involved very deeply to define this structure, but they are community difference here. Scientists along the line, they are only interested in finding the metamaterial structure. Engineer and technological guy, they won't have application. So they totally view totally different angle. Their only problem, they go at resonant frequency, they find the dip, they are happy about at any frequency along DC to daylight, if they find the permittivity, permeability, either single index, either yeah or both, have a negative, they publish the paper, the job is done. But how to make the dynamical tune? If I get epsilon at 10.2 gigahertz negative, and another frequency become positive, you cannot make any use of that one. So engineer thinks totally different perspective, and that's why problem is defined. What is major problem, what we feel here, third one, the challenge is if a structure we can make a symmetric, which will be not true in many of the application, that forward and backward impedance in dynamic mode, they're different, they modulate about epsilon and mu. And the method of measurement is very trivial. There are 3 methods they select. One is numerical method, which is not, we can experimentally verify them. And then you have field theory, E by H, where Maxwell, most of the time equation fail to address epsilon and mu. If you have a slab where dynamically both epsilon and mu becomes positive and negative, there will be boundary condition, which is very difficult to solve. The third structure, Nicholson Rogewire developed very nice innovative method to define, retrieve the value of complex epsilon and mu. But this method also failed to address when epsilon and mu goes dynamically at the same time negative. Researchers are working, and they are close to the, you know, without, it's not like it's have 10% in error, but it is close to the real approximations. How to realize them? It is a simple structure. The simplified form, what you see, it is not. It will be array in both the you know, dimensional. But simple structure, if you can formulate inductance and capacitance based on Green theorem, yeah, integrating whatever the mathematical tools you want to have it, you have a coupling capacitor, indexes, other factors. This is a wire, this is a split ring. It will be a series of array that defines you at the some region permittivity, permittivity negatives. The factor you see, the frequency I forgot to mention here, it was 420 gigahertz. So that was the dimension was very small in the in millimeter range. Fabrication becomes very difficult in discrete domain. So we wanted to know something in Rohde substrate and 3.3 yet and can do something at least around 10 gigahertz to 5 gigahertz. That makes sense. And I want to thank Dr. Rohde to give us it required good amount of money to do the foundry level. So Fraunhofer Institute developed this kind of resonator, which was quartz and glass. We did simulation around 8 gigahertz. Unfortunately, it is working around 16 gigahertz, so it is better science, but the mathematical prediction and simulation did not correlate with experimental, but experimental result gives the desired outcome what we anticipated. Now, people might think of why not simple transmission line, why we are bending and in the way we like. And Dr. Jeremy is here, he is very good in coupling and all other things, do the microstrip line, printed line, many combinations, and he has done a very superior quality job. But one can see over here, just I gave the example, if you have simple ring structure, if you have closed ring, the frequency is defined. You have a lambda by 2 that determines the frequency of ring resonator. But if you make a split ring, then it becomes electrical coupling, magnetic coupling, depends upon how dynamically changes. You can reduce the length from the ring to the split ring. If you make this structure, what I am doing, twisting over here, now I am, these two rings are independent, they are only cut in middle. Here what is happening is a regular loop, they are not cut, they are just connecting, and what we will do from internal ring to outer ring, I will connect with jumper via that shape, the Möbius shape. The advantage will look what it brings to Möbius. If you go three loop and it go infinite n loops, what has happened, it still maintains the same fundamental frequency, but see the size gets reduced. So integrated oscillator guy, I would like to address the optical guy who wants to have a 10 kilometer in a cable, they can be very well defined in 100 meter, 1 kilometer, if they can derive negative index materials. And then job will be not easier, what we have it two-dimensional Smith chart to three-dimensional, because when you define, when epsilon mu becomes negative, it will be not as easy to plot all matching network. It will go to hyperbolic Smith chart where epsilon mu becomes negative. I do not want to spend much of time because the paper this describes. Here's the fundamental advantage. And our company is doing, because you have a fifth generation wireless communication, modern communication network and wireless, frequency 8 node defined, but it will last up to 70 to 80 gigahertz. So we received the inquiry about anything about 30 gigahertz, 60 gigahertz frequency. They want to have tunable sources. We are very having difficulty to finding the tuning diode that can give us even tuning above 20 gigahertz. So we always ended with the multiplying source. We make 10 to 15 gigahertz source and multiply whatever time to get required frequency region. And tuning diodes gives a lot of headache. And there was one approach to try active inductor to tune them, they are very power hungry, and the noise level you cannot beat them because you have to inject current and voltage, then you live with the noise floor and other factors. What is happening over here, if you control the mu and epsilon, then you do not need tuning diodes. So if graphene becomes the transistor candidate and you can have metamagnetic structure, the first target will be 100 to 200 gigahertz sources, which will take the fifth generation, other generation wireless. So that's why research is funding this kind of sources. The earliest trial was done in MEMS at lowest frequency, but they failed to address any negativity parameter because these are the phenomena observed at high frequency. This graph, this was experimentally reported by Professor Pender in the UK. What he did, that's right, if you extreme left, right medium, it was like 10 dielectric constant and mu was available. They have generated arbitrary structure of metamaterial. What they found, when they pump like 100 millivolt signal over here, they can probe it up to 600 millivolt signal here. So it can become voltage amplification without giving any DC power over here. So now there was question how the causality theorem can be imposed over there because the power conservation doesn't follow. If you take the period of time, and period time both the side, then it's follow the power of the energy conservation law. But any moment of given time, you see the voltage amplification. And that's why we do an oscillator, because in oscillator, the duty cycle is not 180 degree. We only do classy operation to get better phase noise and reduction of the noise. Mike is giving hand, so I'll just have to go fast. The Möbius structure, you see the why I'm saying Möbius structure, if you have any closed ring and closed loop, the structure dimension is finished. If it's a Möbius, it's infinite loop. Even it is infinite radius dimension, you have finite dimension, the wave propagate, it will never see the end, it will never meet it. So it gives you the, very high group delay, a very high Q. And another thing, it has anti-gravity role. Let me go quickly. Last year, around the Möbius loop, they have a polarized light that has make the resolution very high. That's why we see the Google Glass. The visibility becomes as good as 4 kilometer and 4 meter. It increases the resolution bandwidth. It's typical resonator structure. The Q you find is around the 1200. You very difficult to get in any printed structure at 10 gigahertz, 1200 to 1300 Q. We have built the oscillators, which you see that at 10 gigahertz, 1 megahertz, 150, we have dielectric resonator, inferior phase noise performance as compared to this. Then we have multi-band structure, which is very good. It has a 2 to 4 gains. It is a concurrent, not like harmonically tuned. Now, this structure had 12 to 18 gigahertz. If you see the figure of merit reported, it is better than any things published to date. 28.5 gigahertz is required from the NASA other places because they want to put space qualifier. They do not want to use cavity. They want to have printed, which should be independent upon gene other factors. The application for comparison, if you see here 3.1 by 1 inch, this huge monster, it requires $500 bill of material to give the phase noise. Here we have $3 to $4 bill of material. Phase noise is exceptionally good as compared, and it is very, very small in size. So in conclusion, there is two candidates, mainly quantum oscillator, and then there will be graphene candidates. And we are doing from very high, like discrete model, to the planar domain, which solves, saves the cost and quality factors increase. And this is my probably last slide. So this is a very interesting. We are doing the research on the Casimir effect with the metamaterial. It gives you anti-gravity solution. This was already published. It can give you anti-gravity solution. That will be application will be enormous. Because any plane, other thing, if you have levitations, so much of the energy, much of the life will be much easier. With that, I'll conclude the talk, and I'm for question. If there's time, then I can have a question.